Because the heart of the story is that all roads lead back to metabolism. The heart of resistance is dynamic, multifaceted, difficult to predict from baseline characteristics. So those are the two themes I'm going to develop through the course of my talk, which is why we need to understand the metabolic consequences of so-called oncogene-targeted therapy, and we need better monitoring tools, which is where Daniel is hopefully taking us with the credentialing of CTCs. Disclosures, some of which are relevant to this talk, other ones not. So just a quick reminder, what we've accomplished over the course of the past now 5 years, at least for BRAF mutant melanoma, so the subpopulation that have activating BRAF mutations, in a series of phase 3 clinical trials in which we compared single agent BRAF inhibitor to chemotherapy, blue curve versus purple curve, improved outcomes, as you can see here, with not very long follow-up on average in these phase 3 trials, just over a year. So substantial increase there, and then by mopping up this within pathway bypass that we and others have documented and corroborated in human tumor samples with BRAF inhibitor monotherapy, gave us our primary motivation to adding a MEK inhibitor to BRAF. And in a series of randomized trials of BRAF-MEK combination therapy versus BRAF, you see the red versus blue comparisons. This is actual an aggregate analysis of all of those randomized trials. Highly statistically illegal to take multiple different data sets and converge them in this way, but it smooths out the data quite nicely and shows you kind of what the net sort of quanta have been in terms of improvement in overall survival. So I'm not going to torture you through all the individual trials that prove that point, but rather just explore now, you know, what have we accomplished, what have we not accomplished, what are the asymptotic limits of MAP kinase pathway targeted therapy, what lies outside or beyond. So another important point, in the era of immunotherapies promulgating and offering really quite substantial benefit for the melanoma population as well, I think it has been quietly assumed that oncogene-targeted therapy, not only in melanoma, but I think others would guess the same in lung cancer and elsewhere, is associated with sort of a monotonic loss of control and emergence of resistance. And in fact, that's not the case. And the curves that I'm showing you here, which just in one figure make the point that even BRAF inhibitor monotherapy has a quote-unquote emerging tail of the curve out through 2 years of follow-up shown here, BRAF-MEK combination therapy, a higher emerging plateau. And we have patients who are 4 or 5 years out, still on therapy, still maintaining disease control, that speak to the fact that there's actually there is something in the way of a tail further out. And the reason I highlight that point is just simply to say that as we continue to focus on the issue of making room for taking advantage of the room for improvement above these curves, if you will, the clinical manifestation of either de novo or acquired resistance, it is also a dual purpose for us to understand what is unique about the makeup and wiring of tumors that are so susceptible and so durably susceptible to these therapies. So again, BRAF inhibitor mono on the bottom, combo on the top, shown here. And the only and last slide I'll show regarding genetics of these tumors is just to remind you of the fact that there is rather significant heterogeneity amongst even an advanced melanoma population. We've reproduced data even to a larger scale than this TCGA data set now, looking at several hundred patients treated on BRAF-MEK combination trials versus BRAF inhibitor monotherapy, where we've performed whole exome sequencing. The clinical correlation analysis is still underway, but the early look at that cohort of clinical trial participants, so this is metastatic patients clearly in need of therapy, recapitulates what you see here, which is this subset of patients on the right-hand side of the figure that have relative genetic simplicity, if you will. I'm not showing you here total mutation burden in these tumors, but in looking at the clinical trial cohorts, we see, in fact, that these patients on the right, where we can't find mutations in these common recurrent mutation sites, really do have lower mutation burden. And it's a fairly simple hypothesis, and one that actually is continually being strengthened with more and more cohorts analyzed, that it's this group that disproportionately derives the long-term benefit. So it's probably one of the simplest hypotheses you could think of to account for this quote-unquote tail of the curve population. May even associate with lower disease burden at time of initiation of therapy, even with patients with radiographically evident metastatic disease, so obviously not very low tumor burden. So when you look at the recurrent alterations in CDKN2A, P10 as the most common co-occurring events, it set up a fairly easy set of hypotheses in terms of nodes of signal transduction that may not be under the control of MAP kinase pathway targeted therapy. I'll come back to this point, obviously, in terms of potential escape hatches. And we've been building combination targeted therapy regimens to try to intercept what we anticipate to be inadequate control of the PI3 kinase pathway, CDKN2A as well. But one of the points of frustration as we've done that is that preclinical experiments and early, this is still phase one work, clinical studies don't really give us a strong sense that genotype really points us in the direction of who should be getting these combination regimens. In other words, when you add a CDK4 inhibitor, PI3 kinase pathway inhibitor as well, there's not a simple correlation lining up with the genetic alterations suggested here on this slide when you look at individual cell lines, patient tumor samples, the like. So pivoting now to representation of heterogeneity of response typical of all oncogene-targeted therapies, we know that patients who have complete responses have the most durable, incomplete, obviously the most common situation. Some of those can be durable, but the vast majority are where resistance comes from. But just consider how much bulk tumor remains across this population of patients. This is not inducing remission of the leukemia lymphoma sort down to undetectable amounts of disease by conventional measures. No, these patients have a lot of tumor burden remaining. And in trying to understand what are the underpinnings of this, this has really been the work of the past several years now. One simple statement that was supported even with BRAF inhibitor monotherapy is inadequate control of the MAP kinase pathway doesn't seem to be an obvious suggestion for this heterogeneity of response. We see apparent homogeneity when we looked even at a decent-sized cohort of serial tumor biopsies before and early on therapy. This is with BRAF inhibitor monotherapy. We've repeated some of this work with BRAF-MEK combination therapy, and if anything, on this same sort of semi-quantitative assessment of MAP kinase pathway output, we see really remarkably consistent control and maybe even a little deeper suppression of phospho work early in the course of therapy. There is always heterogeneity within the tumor sample. I continue to show an individual case when I'm showing this data because every single tumor that we've looked at, you can always find phospho-ERK positive cells within the field of tumor. And we've still done really quite a poor job of understanding this degree of heterogeneity within a sample. What accounts for some tumors being able to maintain pathway output even when the vast majority are suppressed, but it's probably an important underpinning to understanding resistance when we get to deeper and deeper responses. So despite this fairly marked degree of inhibition with BRAF inhibitor monotherapy and homogeneity, it was a little surprising that when we added a MEK inhibitor to BRAF inhibitor, we actually significantly improved upfront response to treatment, but we did. Response rate was higher, complete and near complete response rate is higher, and as I suggested with that progression-free survival curve, there are patients who maintain durable response more likely with a combination, and not surprisingly, they come from this sort of deeper response subset. So yes, just by optimizing MAP kinase pathway control, we've been able to improve that outcome to some degree, but still a lot of tumor burden remaining, even in this population after dual pathway blockade. The common theme that we observe with BRAF inhibitor monotherapy, just to remind you of some early principles, is that in most cases we saw reactivation of the MAP kinase pathway. This is a cohort, a subset of the patients who had had early biopsies to be able to then demonstrate that reactivation of the pathway compared to early on therapy control was typically observed, but to a varying degree. You had really robust reactivation, more modest, and then a subset that were clinically progressing but still had really marked suppression of the pathway. Now turning to BRAF-MEK combination therapy, we have about this number of samples characterized in a similar fashion, and this is part of a manuscript that's being put together now. I just didn't have the figure constructed yet, but suffice to say we are getting a little bit of a shift. So in other words, at progression on BRAF-MEK combination therapy, we see more of this phenomenon, a little bit less, but maybe still 50% of cases anyway with reactivation of the pathway. And in trying to understand the mechanisms of BRAF inhibitor monotherapy resistance that can reactivate the pathway, summarized here and enumerated by our group and others in real patient tumor samples as being the mechanisms by which pathway reactivation can be accomplished without altering BRAF itself, at least with gatekeeper mutations. When we look at BRAF-MEK combination therapy, we still see some of the same genetic explanations showing up in the acquired resistance sample not present at baseline, and even looking at the whole exome level, we see some tumors that don't have any alterations that are new in the progressing sample compared to baseline. This is a small mini cohort that we published last year. We have three or four times this number now that are part of this manuscript in preparation right now. And suffice to say, similar balance here, but maybe more like a 50-50 split of putative MAP kinase pathway reactivating mechanisms, even on BRAF-MEK combination therapy, but a bigger representation of this phenomenon of no alterations and no biochemical evidence of pathway reactivation either. So tightening the screws in the MAP kinase pathway seems to be pushing at least a little bit towards compensatory signaling through other means. I'll just briefly state, though, that we may still have room for improvement in the MAP kinase pathway. So before closing out this sort of introductory portion of the talk, we are exploring in every one of these strategies right now in our phase one program, deploying typically doublets, but we still are, we're looking at some novel monotherapies as well, trying to understand if there are alternative strategies for trying to disrupt BRAF, CRAF, or downstream signaling as well. Again, monotherapy or combination therapy regimens. The BRAF inhibitors that we have currently are of a particular sort. Many of you know they cause paradoxical activation in certain contexts, and we wonder, in fact, whether they support CRAF signaling and support CRAF bypass as a common feature and maybe a vulnerability, actually, of that of this class of BRAF inhibitors. So there may be room for other types to emerge. That's still a work in progress to understand, well, we'll have therapeutic index with any of these approaches, so a little early to include them as a potential strategy in the future. So let me shift gears to this problem, which we saw even with BRAF inhibitor monotherapy, but we're beginning to see more and more now with BRAF-MEK combination therapy, which is this non-MAP kinase pathway reactivation-associated progression. So the mechanisms that have been suggested, even in the days of BRAF inhibitor monotherapy, experimentally with some, but more limited clinical corroboration, was the notion that the PI3 kinase pathway can be an easily accessed bypass track in these tumors. Individual receptor tyrosine kinases, each of which have been demonstrated functionally in vitro and corroborated at least to some degree in vivo, and RTKs that, when expressed at baseline, or activated at baseline at least, seem to be able to confer resistance as well. So ones that are upregulated early on therapy or expressed at baseline, all of them have been implicated as being able to activate PI3 kinase pathway flux and drive resistance. The problem is that none of these even appear to be particularly good predictive biomarkers. They don't seem to be able to predict which tumors will engage this mechanism and be dependent on PI3 kinase pathway signaling for resistance, and none of these have been able to be predicted, which is to say they're all adaptive mechanisms that have no genetic underpinning or any other static biomarker that we can point to. This is a major problem because the more and more we think that this is one of the easiest bypass mechanisms to manifest, if we don't have a way of predicting its utilization, how are we possibly going to deploy therapies in any precision medicine mode to overcome it? So taking this question back to the laboratory, at least an MGH version of this work is summarized briefly here, where several years ago we took a panel of BRAF mutant cell lines. This was work done in Jeff Engelman's lab at the time, using vemurafenib, and it was a BRAF inhibitor, and pulling a panel of cell lines that had the type of representative sensitivity to resistance that we and others have seen clinically, as well as in other larger in vitro screens, either at the level of growth arrest or induction of apoptosis, one can readily see heterogeneity to a large degree across a panel of melanoma lines that harbor the same activating BRAF mutation. And looking at a broad signal transduction profile beyond just the analytes shown here, the recurrent theme that came out of this analysis was that phospho-ERK suppression was observed essentially regardless of whether cells were in the sensitive category or the insensitive category. So phospho-ERK suppression was essentially uniform, and that did not discriminate which way tumors went in terms of sensitivity or resistance. What came out very consistently as being the divergent biomarker was phospho-S6, canonical downstream marker of PI3 kinase pathway activation, but as many of you know, has also been shown to be under the control of ERK and RISC to some degree outside of cancer systems and increasingly in cancer as well. But it seems to vary, and that I think is an important point. And it seems to vary in a way that is not easily predicted, certainly not with genetics anyway. And based on our efforts so far, not based on RNA or protein-based biomarker strategies either. But it seems to suggest a fork in the road where some tumors will have persistence of phospho-S6, even up to very high concentrations of a BRAF inhibitor. Others have really marked suppression and suppression that really mirrors their sensitivity at the level of phospho-ERK. So giving us at least a biomarker readout of a fork in the road in terms of this what appears to be readily engaged bypass track in the PI3 kinase pathway and relying on phospho-S6 to essentially report on utilization of that bypass track. So looking at the full panel of cell lines that I showed in the first figure, this seemed to sort cells quite nicely. Again, whether one looked at growth arrest or apoptosis, phospho-S6 inhibition or persistence, so yes or no, suppression or not suppression, seemed to sort the cells quite nicely based on that initial distribution. So we became more interested in the translational and clinical relevance of this, and a bridging experiment performed by Ryan Corcoran and Mike Rothenberg at the time, and was a bridge to the Haber lab, was to look in xenografts constituted with a sensitive and resistant model. So a single cell line that we knew in vitro was sensitive and one that was resistant, and ask in the xenograft system, could you score the same divergence in terms of suppression of phospho-S6 in the sensitive model and persistence in the resistance model? It actually held up quite nicely. What you're looking at here is a fine needle aspirate and single cell analysis, quantitative analysis of phospho-S6. Which at the time and presently, single cell analyses continue to be a technologic feature of the Haber lab's work, yes for CTCs, but for tumor cells as well. So we took this as reasonably nice corroboration and then took the experiment straight to the clinic and asked when we biopsied patients very early in the course of therapy and at baseline, so after just a week or so of treatment, could we monitor this node that was differentially regulated using phospho-ERK suppression as the quote-unquote positive control? Here's just a single patient. So a fine needle aspirate before, and on day 8, you see very nice suppression of phospho-ERK. No, it's not complete, as I've suggested in the IHC data. You will always see some cells that are still phospho-ERK positive. In this case, phospho-S6 was very nicely suppressed. And in a small cohort of just 17 patients to start with, just to try to understand the sort of ability to monitor this node and understand was it really bimodal, it did appear to be bimodal, and it seemed to be able to segregate even a very small cohort of patients. Those who didn't have suppression of phospho-S6 did very poorly relative to those who did have suppression of phospho-S6, some of whom went on far longer than just the 1.5 year follow-up time shown here. And this is very early in the course of therapy. So we're monitoring patients in this instance at day 8. Here's a case of day 15 in a couple of patients. And so we can look at a very, very early time point, see a fork in the road being taken, and this seems to have ramifications in terms of long-term disease control, not just early response to treatment. As we circled back in this series of patients and others since, back to the genetics to try to understand, well, was there something at baseline that would have predicted which tumors would go which way, the answer continues to be no. P10 deletion sometimes shows up in this group, but not a common explanation, and that's only a relatively small subset of all BRAF mutant melanoma anyway, and this seems to be a relatively common bypass track above and beyond that. So genetics don't seem to be the opportunity to get us there. So let me pivot from that. I'll come back to it a little bit in a moment. To the other dimension of resistance, in this case to MAP kinase pathway targeted therapy, but I think it's an emerging theme that this work points toward in all oncogene targeted therapy circumstances, which is to say that downstream of the oncogenic pathways that we're targeting, and even when we mop up resistance bypass tracks at the signal transduction level, a recurring theme is that transcriptional regulation and changes in cell state seem to be a very common feature. Now, remind you that melanoma is not an epithelial malignancy, so EMT is never a phrase that we've used in this disease, and we wouldn't be able to see it under the microscope as looking like an epithelial to mesenchymal transition. But we think the parallel in epithelial malignancies is the EMT phenotype that Daniel's group has been able to read out in the setting of breast cancer with ER-targeted therapy. The lung cancer group here and elsewhere have seen the same, and in fact, more and more EMT resistance coming out with third-generation EGFR inhibitors compared to first-generation EGFR inhibitors. So this is a common theme, and we think we stumbled upon this same feature in this work that originated in Levi Garraway's lab and then connected with our group here in terms of understanding its clinical relevance. In Levi's lab, they took just a single BRAF mutant model, A375, which is arguably the biggest workhorse in the field, treated that cell with a RAF inhibitor in one set of experiments, MEK inhibitor, RAF-MEK combination, or an ERK inhibitor, so trying to carpet bomb the MAP kinase pathway with individual or two-drug therapy, and asked when they forced the expression of open reading frames, what was it that could confer resistance commonly to any of these strategies? So looking ahead basically a couple of years, if we actually do increase the toolbox beyond RAF-MEK therapy, even to include ERK inhibitors, what would it effectively be beyond the reach in terms of being able to drive resistance? And you see here the common hits really vastly scored within the transcription factor realm. And notably, in each of these quadrants, MITF kept showing up, as well as other related transcription factors in the family. But MITF, in every instance, was able to serve this function. That was of particular interest to us for several reasons, one of which is that David Fisher here at MGH is the field's guru of MITF-related biology in melanoma, and particularly its potential therapeutic relevance. So two bodies of work emerged in parallel from David's laboratory that seemed to explain how it is that MITF actually could drive resistance. Now, an important background piece of information that I'm skipping over for the sake of time is that it had been documented preclinically that oncogenic BRAF suppresses MITF, that's essentially a native state of affairs in BRAF mutant melanoma. And in fact, in NRAS mutant melanoma, another large subset, you can see the same phenomenon of MITF suppression by and large. So when you inhibit with a BRAF inhibitor, this was actually known before we had effective clinical BRAF inhibitors, but in experimental systems, when you inhibit BRAF or silence it, you restore MITF expression. So it goes up in the net. And understanding the relevance of that led down two paths, which I'll briefly review, both of which seem to be partial explanations for how it is that MITF upregulation could actually be essentially a downstream consequence that could confer resistance and maybe an unintended consequence of targeting upstream oncogenic BRAF. Unintended meaning that we wouldn't have initially anticipated that we'd run into this problem of lineage-specific biology coming back to bite us. BCL2A1 expression is its own interesting story because it seems to be a melanocyte and melanoma specific BCL2 isoform that seems to have particular relevance, and then this switch to oxidative phosphorylation, which is not unique to melanoma. I think several groups now have shown in other oncogene-targeted therapy contexts that the Warburg effect can, in fact, be reversed in the setting of oncogene-targeted therapy with increased utilization of oxidative phosphorylation, which seems to actually drive resistance to some degree. So first, just a quick snapshot of data that we've produced over and over again beyond just this cohort here, but I'm showing you this cohort of patients because we sought to understand in humans whether MITF upregulation happens consistently and to a large degree in terms of magnitude. And we always see this type of distribution. I suppose you could call it bimodal, where you have a subgroup of patients who have a couple-fold increase in MITF, which could be functionally important, and then a handful of patients here who have much more marked upregulation. We use melanocyte lineage antigens as reporters of MITF transcriptional activity. There are other transcription factors that act in a yin-yang relationship with MITF, so just seeing MITF go up alone wouldn't convince you that it was now going to be driving transcriptional state in these cells. But it is true that the downstream reporter genes, if you will, in human tumor specimens are markedly upregulated. You see instances here that are quite compelling, but in the aggregate across a cohort of patients, you see upregulation of MART1, GP100, tyrosine isolated protein 1 and 2 as a consistent finding. But there are these differences in magnitude, and we didn't understand when we first produced this data whether all of this would point in the direction of resistance to therapy, or maybe only those instances where there was marked upregulation, or maybe we needed to measure other transcription factors as well. So going to this resistance observation, Neil Rosen's group at Sloan Kettering had scored gene sets that were altered in the setting of BRAF inhibitor therapy or gene silencing. And in fact, had observed that genes in the TCA cycle were the most consistently upregulated across panels of melanoma cell lines, including some of the workhorse models that many groups have looked at in terms of trying to understand the wiring of resistance. So this was just an observation that was tucked away in supplemental data a couple of years prior to this analysis, but suggested that this was a real phenomenon, at least in vitro, that was commonly occurring and, in fact, was the predominant alteration observed. So the work in terms of trying to relate that to the MITF upregulation that I've already shown you happens in patients had a few transition experiments that I'm only briefly going to touch upon. One is that in cell lines, consistently you can see this switch of decreased lactate production. You can see here in the BRAF mutant context, this is a BRAF wild type line that doesn't have this effect to a BRAF inhibitor. But it does seem to consistently occur. There's increased mitochondrial biogenesis and a variety of functional studies that triangulated in on PGC1-alpha as being the fork in the road and poisons of mitochondrial complex 1 that seem to be able to overcome resistance. But of course, that's not a readily deployable treatment strategy. At least the agents that were used in these studies certainly don't have the therapeutic index we would need in humans. But we corroborated in human tumor samples, again, this type of bimodal phenomenon. And this is really the feature that I wanted to land on in terms of this sort of dynamic fork in the road phenomenon that we don't seem to be able to predict based on genetics or any other baseline feature, where we see the MITF upregulation that I've shown you before and was reproduced in this data set as well. But more importantly, this PGC1-alpha upregulation that is quite marked in a subset, but much more modest, if at all, upregulated in others, corroborated here with IHC, but at the RNA level as well as protein. And so it suggests that at least with regard to this MITF putative, MITF-mediated metabolic switch, that this is another phenomenon in which tumors can go one way or the other. Now, we don't have a ready therapeutic opportunity in terms of agents to deploy, but you can imagine that if we were able to monitor this phenomenon as it occurred early or later in the course of therapy, we think it happens early because these are early on treatment biopsy specimens, then deploying an agent that could poison this metabolic dependence might be a strategy we would want to use, but only for the subset of patients whose tumors go in this direction, leaving others who don't have this phenomenon occur, who, based even on this data in this paper, seem to do better in terms of longer-term duration of response, leave them on their backbone therapy, but only deploy the combination relevant to this group. Similarly, this MITF BCL2A1 work started with previously available data that suggested that BCL2A1 is the most tightly regulated by MITF in the melanocyte lineage. So whether you look at normal melanocytes or melanoma cells, you can see this fairly tight relationship, and that was a background launching point into trying to understand the functional relevance of this. Turns out that BCL2A1, in fact, can be the underpinning of survival in vitro. If you silence BCL2A1 expression, that does impair growth and survival, both in vitro as well as in xenografts. Silencing MITF really markedly undercuts BCL2A1 expression, and silencing BCL2A1 in combination with a BRAF inhibitor markedly increases apoptosis. So all of those studies suggest that it might have therapeutic relevance. Looking into humans, again, we saw MITF upregulation, which we had is the underpinning of all of this work, and we continue to look at it as the primary fork in the road that when it is markedly upregulated, driving BCL2A1 expression up early in the course of therapy, that actually seems to significantly separate patients in terms of depth of response, so amount of tumor regression early in the course of therapy. Those that don't upregulate BCL2A1 are the ones with the most marked responses. Those that do have substantially diminished responses. And we know that depth of response associates with duration, which was seen in this small pilot, but seems to be one of the coordinates that maps to the resistance spectrum, and perhaps in a non-overlapping way, in fact, with the PGC1-alpha work. We looked to a little degree to see how those interrelate. So both of those studies converge with an understanding that has emerged in the field that, at least in the melanocyte giving rise to melanoma biology, and then therapeutic targeting and resistance landscape, that we are probably looking at a cell state admixture of cells at any given point, which I'll try to convince you of in just a moment, and where when we treat a given patient, we are dealing with some admixture of cells that live at different points on this spectrum. I mentioned before that there are transcription factors that have an inverse relationship with MITF, and in fact, BRAIN2 or BRN2, some like to call it, can in fact regulate MITF and vice versa. There are other transcription factors, including PAX3, that seem to be part of this loop, which is admittedly complex, but what seems to occur in melanoma cells is that tumors are, in some instances, forced to one end of the spectrum or another, even in the untreated state. Others live more in the happy medium shown here. This, in experimental systems, reproducibly seems to be the sensitive set, those cells that have a little bit more of a middle-of-the-road MITF axis. So I've repeatedly referred to MITF as a resistance factor, but of course we have patients who respond deeply and durably, so it's not a conundrum that we face in every single tumor, but maybe an emerging theme in some. So in tumors that under, at baseline or under selective pressure BRAF inhibitor therapy, swing wildly to this end of the spectrum, high MITF, low BRAIN2, that's a group that seems to be resistant. But in a separate body of work that I've not yet alluded to, there is also the emerging sense that low MITF, high BRAIN2 is its own problem. In other words, there are two different directions that tumors can go in terms of transcriptional regulation. I've highlighted the MITF high, but MITF low might be its own problem in terms of therapeutic resistance. What's interesting about this group is that this is a group that actually begins to express neural crest markers and therefore looks a lot more like a dedifferentiated version. Again, it's a little difficult for us to score that phenotypically in melanoma, but in terms of expression profile, they begin to look more like their neural crest precursors. And more work suggests that this is important in terms of therapeutic resistance and another fork in the road that we have to accommodate for in our monitoring strategies. A little bit hard to anticipate how to use it in terms of a predictive strategy. Although there's work that even just predates the introduction of effective BRAF inhibitors that suggests that in real humans with real metastatic tumors, you can see this type of heterogeneity. In other words, you can see tumors that lie along the spectrum of high to low MITF and the inverse relationship with BRAIN2. So these are actual biopsies of tumor nodules in patients where you can see representation of this skewing. So right in the middle, a mixed population of tumor cells that have both phenotypes present, skewing to the high BRAIN2, low MITF, or vice versa. So this heterogeneity seems to be something that actually can be manifested in tumors even in the untreated condition. Then when we treat with therapy, the suggestion is that some subpopulation of these cells would go the direction of apoptosis, others would survive and potentially hide in either the high MITF state or the low MITF state. So what might drive resistance in the low MITF state? That's the work that was motivated initially by this analysis, where again, a panel of BRAF mutant cell lines were taken in vitro, treated with BRAF inhibitor, scored the typical spectrum of resistance, and then tried to understand, okay, well, we anticipate that low MITF, based on others' work, would confer resistance, but how? In other words, what genes associate with that phenomenon, either upregulation or downregulation? And interestingly, what came up in a set of genes that were markedly and consistently upregulated in the low MITF state were, for example, in this analysis, AXL. And that actually alone seemed to be able to describe this dual phenotype. High MITF, low AXL, and the inverse, low MITF, high AXL, seemed to be a phenotype that we could use to score this low MITF state and relative therapeutic resistance. So now I'm showing you progression-free survival, and in a relatively modest cohort of our patients where we looked at baseline now, so for the first time actually cataloging patients before they saw therapy for this transcriptional state, saw a threefold difference in median progression-free survival. It was statistically significant. You can see that there's overlap in this analysis, but it was a relatively small cohort. But it suggested that the low MITF high AXL tumors were in fact disproportionately the de novo resistant early escape subset versus this group that contained some of the long-lasting responses that I showed you from the very beginning. It turns out that the story is a little bit more complicated. Multiple of the receptor tyrosine kinases seem to be coordinated in this MITF low state. So this is group from this is data from Daniel Pieper's group at the Netherlands Cancer Institute, nicely assaying the larger panel, a far larger panel than shown here, in fact, of receptor tyrosine kinases, and seeing really coordinated expression between the MITF low and high state. So it seemed to be the whole set, and in fact, trying to poison individual or multiple components of this RTK set seemed to be able to overcome resistance experimentally. And the problem with that, of course, is we're never going to get away with poisoning a large portion of the receptor tyrosine kinase tree. At least that's my strong bias based on having worked with a large swath of multi-kinase inhibitors over the years. But it at least points to the functional validation of the importance of this biology. So that all of this emerging understanding has really pointed us to wanting to try to understand if there is a point of convergence, a node that we could find to try to short-circuit this biology. So a low MITF state feeding the upregulation and the coordinated upregulation of the RTK family, then facilitating the PI3 kinase pathway escape mechanism that I began with as one of the critical escape hatches that we know we need to close off. So Zev Ronai, a longstanding collaborator, another transcriptional maven in melanoma, began an exploration to try to understand how to poison this loop and looked in the ubiquitinome for a potential answer. Was there something in the ubiquitin family that he could find in an unbiased screen, here looking at gene silencing of the entire family of ubiquitin family members here? RNF-125 came out just as an unbiased hit in terms of silencing and overcoming therapeutic resistance in the initial cell line that he explored, correlated nicely between in a panel of cell lines for, between sensitive and resistant cells. So low RNF-125 is what seemed to confer resistance and high sensitivity. And then mapping out in a series of experiments that I'm skipping over because this work was just published, he was able to isolate JAK1 as a known client that interacts with RNF-125. In fact, he looked at all known direct binding partners of this E3 ubiquitin ligase, and JAK1 was the only one that, when it was silenced or drugged with a tool compound, could overcome resistance quite nicely as a single agent, as opposed to attempting to target multiple receptor tyrosine kinases simultaneously. And really quite a profound effect in vitro shown here. Now there are emerging JAK1 selective inhibitors. Many of you may know that the first generation of agents were JAK2 leaning. There are some dual JAK1, JAK2 inhibitors, but to follow this work, and Zev actually looked in these experiments to see if JAK2 had any relevance at all in this loop, and it didn't seem to. So to maximize therapeutic index, we would want JAK1 selective inhibitors, and it turns out that there is one just in the phase one trials right now. And we've petitioned for access for it for preclinical work, and then if the phase one study goes reasonably well, then we know where we'd want to take it in terms of a combination strategy to try to squelch this bypass mechanism, which may be something we could read out at baseline in terms of these low MITF, high AXL tumors, and trying to poison this. So it suggests, in fact, that this loop really is the underpinning of this bimodal population that has been demonstrated in untreated tumors, seems to be a divergence that is created under selective pressure of therapy as well, and obviously may not be the entire story, but certainly a tractable hypothesis that can be tried clinically, and we know what biomarkers we would use to corroborate the effect. So I'll just close with the fact that MAP kinase pathway targeted therapy in BRAF mutant tumors and others certainly is a work in progress that has a long way to go outside of melanoma, but we certainly hope that some of the principles that we're uncovering in BRAF mutant melanoma as the prototype example will extend elsewhere. You're all familiar with the relative inefficacy of BRAF inhibitor monotherapy or even BRAF-MEK combination therapy in BRAF mutant colorectal cancer, which interestingly continues to be the far outlier, with lung cancer, thyroid cancer, as being a bit more like melanoma in terms of reliable responsiveness to BRAF inhibitor therapy. Finally, intercepting the EGFR upregulation loop, which is a recurrent theme even in melanomas. Not an epithelial derived tumor, has no business depending on EGFR based on any functional studies that have ever been done before, but does seem to actually utilize EGFR as part of the program. You wonder whether this now clinical validation of the bypass loop through EGFR is not simply because it's an epithelial malignancy, but speaks to a state that colorectal cancers live in that allows them to more readily engage this RTK mechanism that maybe, in fact, be more multifaceted than just EGFR. Although this data, I take, is very encouraging, Now you're looking at three-drug therapy, a BRAF inhibitor, a MEK inhibitor, plus an EGFR antibody, and you're still not up to the level of efficacy that we see with BRAF inhibitor monotherapy in BRAF mutant melanoma. So I would postulate that there's parallel work to be done in this instance to understand whether this vast de novo resistance here is simply a consequence of the fact that what's being intercepted here is only a component of the same mechanism that we've uncovered in melanoma. So I'll just leave with this concept that we continue to mine as deeply as we possibly can, not just at the genetic level, but now, as I've suggested, at the transcriptional level, to identify static biomarkers that would allow us to know which patients can go on the therapy that we would predict to be beneficial to them in the long run, assign them to that therapy. If we can't predict it, we need some way of understanding which way these tumors will go. And we're very interested here in the notion of using ex vivo, if possible, and if necessary, in vivo testing, CTCs would be an example, to try to understand whether we can predict which way or monitor which way tumors are going early in the course of therapy. If we have to go to biopsy, we'll do it, but we'd certainly love it if blood-based biomarkers would get us there. Although I didn't explore it today, we have similar hypotheses that would push us towards the notion of preferring immunotherapy over targeted therapy depending on the phenotype of tumors after such an early run-in. And then ultimately, the idea of deploying higher order combination therapies, but only in tumors that tell us that they need to have such agents added, is where this work is headed. Whereas continuing therapy without alteration for those patients who don't have their tumors go down an adverse fork in the road is where we would ultimately like to see this work lead, because it's not high order combination therapy, more toxicity for everybody, only higher order regimens that for those who need it. Thanks so much for your attention, and I'll leave you with my acknowledgments.
Great talk, Keith. In order to understand whether the phosphor S6 resistant mechanism is an epiphenomenon or a true indeed effect, have you tried mTOR inhibitors in those patients to see whether you decrease the phosphor S6 and you improve? And the second, how do you put together this S6 and the MITF? I haven't found the link.
Right. We don't know that there is a link, to answer that question quickly. But just, I skipped over that experiment. A dual mTOR kinase inhibitor as opposed to rapamycin analog does seem to be able to confer sensitivity in those tumors that have persistence of phosphor S6. So mTORC1, mTORC2 inhibitors, which is...
But in patients, have you tried adding those patients who have you resistant?
Sorry, I skipped over that. So that is one of the regimens that we're building right now in phase one. And really, for every one of these strategies of overcoming resistance, we have this portfolio of phase 1B triplet, BRAF, MEK plus XYZ regimens. The issue is where to park them, right? Because it will clearly, in our minds, not be a one-size-fits-all strategy, but deployment of each of these regimens accordingly. We still don't know that even mTOR targeting is the optimal from a therapeutic index perspective. It may not be. There may be other points in the pathway that we could target. And actually, the JAK work is where I would say that may, in fact, be part of the way to intercept even the upregulation of RTKs that seems to drive some of that program. We think, basically, that the world is dividing. And as we've looked in models anyway, it does seem to be the case that PI3 kinase pathway bypass track mechanism can have its own a life of its own, but the MITF driven mechanisms can also, it seems to be determinant of resistance as the predominant driver. But there's an overlap there. In fact, some of the work I was trying to show is suggesting that there is a communication between the MITF restored state and that RTK program. But we think that's a spectrum in and of itself. It's one that we would suggest from this work we have to monitor because we don't know how to fully predict.
So the JAK1 is an immunosuppressive consideration, so it may not be the best based on the PD-1 story.
No, totally fair point. And mechanistically, it has its promise here. JAK1 selective agents, at least in patients, only this one from Insight is the first to ever be brought into the clinic, so we have to see whether JAK1 selectivity versus JAK2 actually cleans up any of that or not. But
thank you.
Yep.
Simple question, actually. So the most of the BRAF resistance mechanism, as you had alluded, is partly through the MITF, but there's always a crosstalk. You have already touched the S6 pathway, but how about the HIPPO pathway where the CRAF to MST is like a year ago it was published, and even you were on that paper where the YAP is there. And the second part is like MITF is upregulated in 10% of metastatic melanomas, 2006 from the Levi Garaway,
yep.
David Fisher. And in the BRAF resistance, what percent of patients do exhibit an increase in MITF?
Yeah.
And also the MITF mostly goes to the differentiated, like Rick Marais had shown, the
correct.
Increasing pigmentation, right?
Correct.
So how does it shift from a pigmentation state to like an axial mediated resistance of the PGCR?
Yeah, so those tumors actually seem not to be able to do that. So the second question first, MITF amplification actually doesn't score resistance as profoundly as you might think. It's interesting though, there's relatively few models that are MITF amplified to work with in the lab, but they don't seem to be as dynamic in terms of their altered MITF expression, perhaps not surprisingly if they're hardwired through amplification. But it doesn't seem to just be a standout, you know, worst end of the spectrum in terms of resistance. They lie somewhere in the middle. You don't wipe out those models. And in the patients we've looked at, MITF amplification, similarly, they're not complete responders, nor are they the ones that just immediately blow through. So there's something more concrete about their MITF expression, and I think it probably does have something to do with resistance, but it just doesn't seem to be an outlier. The Hippo pathway work that you alluded to. I'm an enthusiast still that we may be able to stitch that into our grand unified theories that I'm trying to suggest here. We ultimately can parse resistance mechanisms into two major families, transcriptional state, signal transduction escape, and some interrelatedness there as well. We just haven't had enough time yet since that early work to kind of include that in every analysis we've done, patient tissues as well as the models, but as we continue to do this, that's really our focus, is to try to understand every time we uncover what appears to be, a putative new mechanism, is it really just another, breadcrumb in the trail of a previously observed mechanism, but just a different link in the chain that we
have. So is there
before.
A possibility that the MITF and YAP might, like, converge at some point?
Yeah, that link hasn't been seen so much as the YAP PI3K phospho-6 RTK loop. That seems to be converge a bit. And so the YAP HIPPO pathway, which continues to be sort of undruggable at least from a human perspective, we'd like to prove that functionally, that it actually phenocopies the same effect. So silencing it does seem to do that. That wasn't in that initial paper that described the phenomenon, but in subsequent work, that's exactly where we're headed, is to continue in this portfolio of models to understand what it segregates with. But for silencing studies, it seems to go that way.
Thanks. Yeah.